attacks in Paris that claimed 17 lives energized the debate around the world about what role Islam plays in the problem of terrorism and, more importantly, the solution.
The source for me is the country that is spreading more extremism than any other country, the country that is religion state, is Wahhabism, Salafism, Saudi Arabia. It starts there. For me, that's the first ISIS state. They are sponsoring more extremists than any other country in the world. They are the country that gave us Al-Qaeda. Bin Laden is a Saudi. 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudis.
Radicalization, in my case and in many other cases, we study this on a daily basis through our work. It's our profession. It usually comes down to a combination of four factors, and that's a sense of grievance, an identity crisis, charismatic recruiters who provide a sense of belonging, an alternative sense of belonging from mainstream society, and the role that ideology plays. Ideology not just peddled by governments in the past, like Saudi Arabia, but also by Islamist organizations that are working on the grassroots level across the world, in Pakistan, in Egypt. And so this problem, I want to add and emphasize, isn't just constrained or restricted to Saudi Arabia. What we really need to be doing is protecting our human dignity and human rights and working to build civil society resilience. But that does require more Muslim communities to stand side by side along with everyone else to be more vocal against this ideology.
To me, it's not moderate conservative. It's mainstream versus terrorist or extremist, frankly. It's supporting them financially within the United States, perhaps, so that they can go out and reach out to people in the community, empowering them so they know what to look out for. If someone seems to be alienating themselves, they've left the community, they're gone, maybe they can be radicalized on a computer. But it's about funding and it's about recruits. That's what terrorist groups need. You know, there are not, but not just Saudi. There's money coming from Qatar and Kuwait going to ISIS and going to support extremists. We have to push our allies to clamp down on that, so they don't have the money to be able to recruit. That's part of it.
I think it's fine to call them Islamists as long as we add the caveat that they don't speak for the whole of the faith. Who are we kidding? They think it's a war, and our not using that word is not going to change how they feel about us.
You know, Bobby, I agree with you, and I understand to a certain extent why you think perhaps we can continue to use the term Islamist or war. But at the same time, you know, this is also a war on Islam. This is a lot of Muslims yes. feel as though not only are Muslims the biggest victims, you know, in Syria, every day in Iraq, as we said in Yemen, on the same day that this happened, we saw 35 people killed outside a police station. We've seen what's happened mm-hmm. in Nigeria. So, you know, I think a lot of Muslims feel as though to call them Islamists, to call them Muslims, even though they self-identify as that, is problematic because it plays into this notion that this is strictly a war between the West and its secular values and Islam.
There is no reference in the Quran which prohibits Muslims from drawing a cartoon or an image of the Prophet. This ruling came from the Prophet himself, who was actually concerned about people idolizing him or worshiping idols. He was surrounded by idol worshippers. And so he told people, do not make any images of anything, And it's similar to what's in the Ten Commandments, which says, do not create engraven images. 1400 years, we have not been creating images of prophets or God. But
it didn't start in the Quran.
It did not start in the Quran. It is a prophetic saying.
And is it taught that you're supposed to kill people who do it?
No. It's actually, the Quran actually says that if somebody, mocks your religion, you should go either walk away from them or dialogue with them.
So if you look at the Quran in the broader sense, 114 times it's mentioned in the Quran that God is the most gracious and the most merciful. So when I want to tell my children about something, I repeat something which is very important. So 114 times in the Quran it says, God is the most gracious, most merciful, most gracious, most merciful.